This rewind edition of The Teller and the Tale was first broadcast in 2015 from Findhorn, Scotland.
Hello, it's Michael Williams, host of The Teller and the Tale, 30 minutes of storytelling told eye to eye, mind to mind, and heart to heart. And today's show comes from the north of Scotland in the community of Findhorn. And my guest today is one of its longest living residents, Anna Barton. Now, for those listeners not familiar with Findhorn, it describes itself as a spiritual community, an eco-village, and international holistic learning center situated near the village of Findhorn, on the shores of the Moray Firth in the north of Scotland. Findhorn was established way back in 1962 by Eileen and Peter Caddy and their Canadian friend Dorothy McLean. And you can learn a lot more about the community if you go to their website at findhorn.org. My guest today, Anna Barton, was one of the very early residents of Findhorn, coming here a little more than 40 years ago. Anna is a storyteller, a writer, a dancer, and a well-respected elder of the Findhorn community. But before we meet Anna, let's listen to her tell one of her original stories, this one called The Little White Cloud.
One day, a little white cloud was floating along in the sky all by himself when he looked down and saw a little group of people busily hurrying about. He stopped to watch. There was a big gnome lady with a barrel of flowers, two little hairy chaps, and an even smaller elf dressed in green. As he watched, they prepared a lovely picnic, and they all sat down together, laughing, eating and drinking. The little cloud felt sad. "I wish I had some friends," he thought to himself. "I'm lonely up here." Just then, a group of big black clouds came hurrying up to him. "Oh, will you be my friends?" he asked. "Go away," answered one of them. "We've got work to do." And before he could answer, they started sending rain down to the earth. The picnickers looked up as they felt the first drops. "Oh dear," said the little green elf. "We must find some shelter." And as he spoke, the black clouds started bumping into each other and laughing as flashes of light and loud rumblings came from them. "Oh, quickly," squealed the lady gnome. "Thunder and lightning, I must find shelter." And they all ran off, leaving the picnic behind to get soaked. "That's not fair," the white cloud told the black clouds. "They've all gone," said one of them. "Let's go and find some other people and make them run away too." And they all stopped bumping each other and hurried away across the sky, leaving the little cloud all on his own again. And the sun shone down and started drying everything. Soon the gnomes, elf and hairy ones came creeping back. "It's all right, everything's dry and we can go back to our picnic." And they giggled and smiled and sat down again. The little white cloud felt happy. "I don't need friends if they're like those nasty black clouds. I'd rather be by myself and watch everything that's happening below." He gave one last look at the happy picnic and then floated gently away to see what else was happening.
Anna.
Where did you get the inspiration to start writing? Was it being a mum and having kids and you wanted to tell stories?
Well, it was being a mum and having kids because of the Little Red Book.
Yeah.
With all their sayings in.
Yes, yes.
I think that's what started me writing.
Yeah.
But it was after they left home that I really started writing for children.
And did you have an idea that you might make something of the writing, or was it just for yourself?
No,
never. And close friends? And no.
I don't even remember telling close friends that something would pop into my head and I'd write it and then put it away.
Wow, yeah.
I think I sort of wrote those for children that I was teaching. I helped to run the playgroup here when I first came here.
Right. So I'm just remembering, you came to Findhorn 40 years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah. What, if you don't mind me asking, what brought you here? What? Some people don't even know Findhorn's been here that long, but it's been here over 50 years.
That's right.
So you came in the early days.
Yes, I wasn't here at the beginning.
No, but what brought you here? Was it a person?
My husband.
Or your husband, okay.
He was in the RAF.
Oh, right, next door here at the base, yeah.
And one day they were asked to host some of the people here.
Right.
Some of the officers were picked to host them.
To host so residents here, there.
Peter and Eileen.
Yes.
And, you know, some of the top ones.
Peter and Eileen Caddy then, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so they were shown around the RAF. And my husband was sort of intrigued by them. Because they were so different to anything he knew.
Mm-hmm.
So when the caddies invited some back, he was one of the first to apply.
Right.
And he came back and then he started coming over a lot.
Yeah.
And then he started seeing ley lines and beings and used to draw them.
Yeah.
Yep.
And as we were saying earlier, you're one of the longest residents who've lived here continuously.
Yeah.
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 When you look back, what kept you here? Because you had a lovely place in Cornwall, but you were obviously all drawn here. And when you look back over the years, what has it been that's really made it home for you?
The people and the way we all were with each other.
Mm-hmm.
We were in the forefront quite a bit as a family.
Mm-hmm.
At sharings we used to sing and my husband played the guitar.
Mm.
I joined the barbershop choir with a barbershop group with my eldest daughter and we were in that for a long time.
Mm.
And I worked in the office, I worked in the candle studio, I worked in the children's play group, and then eventually I started doing sacred dance and mm-hmm. giving workshops over at Clooney.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so I was always busy.
And with the resurgence of, it's been a big interest in dance again, and well, with programs like Strictly Comes Dancing, people are interested in ballroom dancing now.
Yes.
So yeah, that's you've taken that up and offering classes, yeah.
Yeah, it's just so hard to be able to teach when I can't really dance
mm-hmm.
myself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But sometimes I can, if I'm holding on to the man, I can dance with him to show him something.
Yeah, nice.
I just love doing it.
Yeah.
is aching. Smile even though it's breaking. When there are clouds in the sky, you'll get by if you smile through your fear and sorrow. Smile and maybe tomorrow you'll see the sun come shining through for you.
Tony Bennett and Barbara Streisand singing the classic Smile. And Anna, that's just for you. You're listening to Blues and Roots Radio, and this is Michael Williams with The Teller and the Tale, a half hour of storytelling. Let's get back to our very special guest, the Findhorn storyteller and writer, Anna Barton. Anna?
In your experience, I suppose nowadays so many children are either on video or watching television, or they've got their smartphones, you know, and they're playing games. Why do you think storytelling is so important for kids?
I think it's the physical connection more.
Right.
Than just somebody at the other end of a line.
Yes, yes. That the intimacy of the physical
presence. It's the
presence.
Intimacy, and when you're telling stories, if you need to, you can stop or change it a bit, depending on how the audience is reacting.
Right.
So I think that's important to do that.
To be aware of.
And then to speak to them as well.
Yeah.
You know, if you're talking about the little chick who got lost, you say, would you like to be a chicken? And what sort of noises do chickens make?
Yeah.
You know, and then carry on with the story.
Yeah. So it's like you're inviting them into the story.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
In this next story, Anna reminds us that, well, the best laid plans can go all screwy. It's called My Decadent Bath.
Arriving home, tired and hungry after 5 hours of dancing, I decided to be really decadent and have something while I was soaking my aching body in a hot bath. While I heated some milk and made the toast, I ran the bath and put in some bath oil. As I had to wait for the drink to heat, I washed up a few dishes and cleared up the kitchen. Horlicks made and toast buttered and spread with chicken pate, I made expectantly towards the bathroom. Why didn't I remember that when you empty the water in the kitchen sink, the bath plug pops out? Undaunted, I ran the bath again and put in more oil. Undressed and slid into the steaming water. Gorgeous. Trouble was, there weren't any shelves, so I had to hold the plate all the time and slide forward, knees bent, like one of those exercise rowing machines, to get my drink from beside the taps. I can't sit the other way round with my back to the engine. Things were going swimmingly when, as I slid back from a quick slurp of Horlicks, I tipped the plate and one of my precious toast pâtés disappeared into the bathwater. Oh well. Maybe I just wasn't born to be decadent.
A And that was the story of My Decadent Bath by our guest storyteller this week, Anna Barton. It's been a real pleasure talking to Anna. And we talked about many, many things, about her life and coming to Findhorn, and her taking up writing and writing for children, writing for herself and for others. But in this next story, we get a little bit of Anna's take on the haggis, the Scottish haggis. Now, some of you won't know what a haggis is. Well, after you've heard Anna's story, you'll know far more than you'd ever dared to hope. So let's listen in.
Haggai. Many people believe that haggai are made by butchers. Lots are, but I'll tell you why. To start with, the plural for haggis is haggai. Not many people know that. The original haggis was a small furry hedgehog-shaped animal which lived in the wilds of the Highlands of Scotland. What made it unique was that its legs were uneven. Two short legs on one side and two longer ones on the other side. This was to enable them to run round the mountains. Some had the short legs on the left and some had them on the right, enabling the females to run around one way and the males to run the other way. This was particularly useful in the mating season, when they could meet a partner face to face and not have to run like mad to catch one up. Occasionally, they come down to the lower, flatter ground to graze and to have their babies. In order to walk, they turn sideways with the shorter legs in front and using their back legs to spring forward like a rabbit or a kangaroo. The babies are born with no legs, and when they leave their mothers, they roll around the field and graze here and there. Unfortunately, since man discovered how tasty they are, it was much easier to catch the young ones than chase after the jumpers or climb the mountain. This means there were fewer and fewer haggai around, and man had to start making artificial ones, made from offal, blood, oats and suet, and encased in the animal's stomach. This is what most people are eating nowadays. But if you ever manage to get a real one, you'll see a big difference. However, there is now an association called Save Haggis in Scotland, which is gaining in membership and protecting the babies. By protecting them and forcing the hunters to work hard and catch the older ones, there's been a rise in the birth rate, and hopefully Scotland will never lose its haggai.
And that was the story of the haggis by our guest storyteller, Anna Barton. And by the way, if you happen to be in Scotland, in the north of Scotland in particular, and in or around the Findhorn area, then you must drop in on the third Sunday of every month. We have a storytelling ceilidh. Ceilidh, in the old-fashioned sense, is just a gathering of folk to share stories, songs, poems, music, whatever you have. And Anna's almost always there. She's a regular. And if you want to see and hear Anna live, then come to the Findhorn ceilidh, the wee ceilidh, in the community of Findhorn on the Moray Firth. Okay, I think we have time for another story from Anna. And again, she invites us into her everyday world of ordinariness that sometimes goes askew. And in this next story, Anna tells us about one of those days, and we've all had them.
Have you ever had one of those days when everything goes wrong, or if not exactly wrong, slightly awry? It started when I woke up on a Saturday and thought, great, not a lot to do, I'll lie in for once. After half an hour of blissful lying there and letting thoughts drift across my mind, one of them hit me with a bang. It wasn't Saturday, it was Friday, and I had to be on reception. At 8:45, later, when I was hoovering the house and reaching the bathroom after an uneventful hoove, I was adjusting the soap in the basin with one hand while I held the vacuum pipe in the other, and turning round when the hoover started singing a new note, I saw the end of the toilet roll rapidly disappearing up the spout. Oh, that's really naughty, I scolded. You've been so good up to now. Obviously, it took great exception to being scolded, as minutes later, when I bent to remove an obstinate piece of fluff from the carpet, the hoover seized its opportunity to pay me back and grabbed my scarf in its teeth and commenced to swallow as fast as it could. We had quite a tussle for a minute, as I was prevented from switching it off by the vivid picture of myself doing an Isadora Duncan. One good thing about that day was the flash of inspiration I had while I was chatting away to myself in the process of cleaning the house. I suddenly realised that if a thought is worth having, it's not right to be kept to yourself. Share it. If there's no one to hear it, tell the hoover or the washing up bowl, your plants, or the many different beings who are within earshot.
Good advice. Thanks, Anna. I really appreciate that.
Oh gosh, they really mean something now. Sharing them with other people.
Yeah, it's just so lovely that you have, over the years, collected these stories, you know, written them down and written all from your own experiences of being a mom and just being, you know, a woman and a person in the world and, you know, so on. So, yeah.
But I do try to keep them humorous.
Yeah.
You know, find the funny bits.
Yeah, you do. You always seem to find the humor in every situation.
I try to. Because I was a very serious child. And when my humour started coming out, I all I can remember is that it started coming out when I was on my own. You know, with the children gone and my husband gone. And I suddenly loved this sense of humour that I had. Although it's quite wicked a lot of the time. But the people who know it is are fine with it.
Yeah.
What about something you do for the kids?
I like this one. I'd like to be a skink, I think, with heads at either end. But working out which way to go would drive me round the bend. Really, one is just a tail that looks just like a head. So enemies chase me to the right and I go left instead. I'd rather be a skunk, I think. Yeah, I miss it. I miss telling stories to children.
Yeah, I can see why. And I mean, you and I will agree that I love stories. I think stories are really important.
But yeah.
Love to your imagination.
I didn't have it then.
No. This all, like, well, you said,
I
came
mean,
all later.
It was
later.
Four children under six.
So then maybe the kids gave it to you, that it was their influence on you later.
Could have done later, yeah.
Yeah.
And my grandchildren too.
Yeah. Well, I can say we've been listening to Anna Barton, storyteller, writer, dancer, dance teacher, and probably one of the longest term residents here at the Findhorn Community. And for anyone who's listening, who finds themselves in or near Findhorn on the third Sunday of any month, then you need to come along to our Wee Cayley, which is a gathering of folk that share stories, songs, poetry, music. And almost always, Anna will be there entertaining us all with her stories. And stories of her children, stories of growing up, and just stories of your own experiences. And Anna, you've been writing for a long time, and you're one of those sort of pure writers who writes just for the sheer enjoyment of writing.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. And it's not about money or fame or getting published or anything like that. It's just sharing with other people.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really lovely. And I'm really glad we've had the chance to hear and share some of those stories today.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Yeah, thanks.
Well, we've just about run out of time, but I want to thank my very special guest, Anna Barton, a storyteller, writer, and elder of the Findhorn Community. If you want to learn more about Findhorn, go to their website at findhorn.org. And if you have a comment about today's show, or you want to pass on a message to Anna, or comment on any of our shows, you can email me at iamthestoryteller@gmail.com. iamthestoryteller@gmail.com. That's all one word. Or you can message me through our Facebook site, facebook.com/theteller and the tale. And you can leave us a comment there. You can also go to thetellerandthetale.com, our own website, where you can listen to past shows as well. So there's lots of ways of getting a hold of us. And hey, let me know your story, or if you have a favorite storyteller or a favorite story to tell. I'd love to hear all about it. But until next time, well, this is Michael Williams saying goodbye, and may all your once upon a times end happily ever after. Stay tuned for more music and great stories right here on Blues and Roots Radio.
On a Sunday evening, I'm looking back over all the years and where I've been, looking at a photograph. I'm remembering you were right there, and you have been ever since. With every page that turns, I see your faithfulness. Ooh, the mountain where I climbed, the valley where I fell, you were there all along. That's the story I'll tell. Brought the pieces together, made me the storyteller. Now I know it is well, it is well. That's the story I'll tell. There were some nights I felt like they would last forever, but you kept me breathing. You were with me right. Telling this story over and over again. The mountain where I climbed, the valley where I fell, you were there all along. That's the story I'll tell.